So yes, I'm from Switzerland, but I've been here about 30 plus years. Just briefly where how I came to this, I pretty much spent my life, my career anyway, around business development and economic development. I started out working for an investment firm in South America helping small companies. I worked for about 20 plus years with an international water treatment company doing business development. And how I got into this space, this sustainability space, is I got frustrated that everything around sustainability, and I'm talking back the 80s, 90s, early 2000s in multinational companies, just didn't get much traction. And I didn't have the education, I wasn't always smart enough to know the things, I wasn't always courageous enough in those 60 seconds I had to say something that, well, should we consider this aspect of what we do also on that? So I left that. And I got some training, some online training in sustainability. And for the last 6 years or so, I'm leading now this greenhouse accelerator. We help early stage green clean tech companies. So these are rainwater collection projects, energy efficiency, renewable energy, local food network, anything to do with using fewer resources, using them more efficiently, mitigating the impacts of using them. We work with early stage companies, so not people who have already a business plan and may already have some financing. We help them put a plan together, we help them make connections, we help them get to where they have an intelligent enough story to tell so they can find partners, customers, investors, and such. We're a nonprofit, we do everything pro bono. We're essentially a group of folks who are willing and have time to give back and help somebody to start a business. So that's where I am at the moment. Sustainability in that sense has two aspects, right? It's from a perspective of company, it's what you make, what you sell, whether that is renewable energy, the projects I mentioned. That's sort of the obvious aspect of what you're selling to your customers, what your business is about. The other is how you actually run that business. Do you apply sustainable business practices? And I want to get into a little bit into what that is and give some feedback on how this can be done. Please interrupt me with questions as soon as they come up. I have some slides to sort of underscore the points I'm trying to make, but I don't need to just run through a deck of slides. As soon as you have questions, interrupt me. I'd rather follow your thinking, your questions through the subject and have a discussion than just presenting from here. A couple of other things I'd like to say too. You probably, most of you have seen this, right? I mean, what do you see? What's up there? How old is she? Young lady? She's a two, she's probably seen it before, two ladies. But, I mean, the two of you, you must be crazy, right? You're seeing a young lady, I see an old lady, we're looking at the same thing. Not to believe, I think you all, how many see a young lady in here? How many see an old lady? Okay, there are some. The point I'm trying to make here, and this is important with around sustainability, everybody looks at the same thing. This is a fact, right? It's there. But some of you, see if this is clear for those of you who didn't see it. If you look at this here, this is an ear, this is a nose, this is a chin. That's a young lady, right? Looking that way. This is a nose, this is a mouth, this is the chin. That's an old lady. So the point I'm trying to make is, and this in these days even more important than in earlier times, not to go off on that subject, but we're all looking at facts, we may see them differently. So it is very important that we find ways to understand that different people can look at facts different way, may even see different things, we may interpret them differently, they may mean something different to us. We might actually be wrong in how we look at this. So to approach a subject like sustainability, which comes in its name already with baggage. People have certain preconceived notions about what it is, what it should mean, to approach it in a way that's not confrontational, that doesn't tell people what they have to do, is very important. And be respectful of other people's opinions and just accept the fact that we might actually be wrong. So when I talk about a subject, I'm not telling you what to do. But you'll see in some of the things I try to touch on, what I'm asking you to do is, as you make that decision on what to do, that you are assuming responsibility for the consequences. You make you follow a responsible decision-making process. Instead of calling all these things we're talking about sustainability, I like to call it impact accountability for individuals and particularly for corporations. We need to be accountable to the consequences of our actions. For me, that's ultimately sustainability. Did that raise any questions already right here? I mean, please interrupt me, ask questions if something needs clarification. This is a very general definition from the United Nations. What it could mean. But the point is, sustainable decisions, or if I forget that word, responsible decisions means thinking about it in terms of a longer time horizon, how it affects future generations, how it affects others around us that may be impacted by our decisions today or tomorrow. Sustainable in the sense of being able to continue to do these things on and on without taking options away from others. So we all know we sit on this planet, it has a finite space for waste, for resources, anything else. We need to treat it that way. So what does that mean for relative to impacts that we might have? You know about waste, creates issues about where do we put it, what does it create, there may be some toxic gases coming from the waste lying around, waste out of landfill might pollute water. Water, polluted by what I just said, it's scarce, our activities can pollute it, we may take too much water for what we're doing, whether that's farming, whether that's manufacturing. Air. You make something, you throw some toxic soot through your chimney, you burn it in your car, we affect air. Forests, depends how Home Depot uses wood for their
paper,
for example, or the boards they sell, or IKEA for the cabinets that they sell. How we harvest the woods, it might take too much forest down, but you know, the forests, we know, they produce the oxygen, they function as a carbon sink, those kinds of things. Climate change changes how certain parts of our globe can produce food, if you want it this way. In Africa, in the northern part of Africa, some of the issues we see with regard to wars that are happening, migration that happens, is because the land just doesn't produce anymore what it used to. Another point here, just another effect. Employees, you know, whether you know where if you buy products as an input into what you do from India or from China, how are these people treated there? Do they earn a living wage? Are you employing 10-year-olds? All impacts, again, that are a result of decisions. And the community, you know, does what you do, how does this affect as a company? How does this affect the community around you? Schools that are needed, roads that need to be built, traffic on the roads, all kinds of impacts. Again, coming back to as we make decisions about how we do things, what we produce, how we produce it, we need to find ways to measure that impact. If you take nothing else but this way from what I'm talking to you about here. This triple bottom line concept, in my opinion, is very fundamental. Because essentially what you do, I don't know whether to what extent you talk with other folks who were here before me about how they run a business, what they do in their business. The way businesses are run today normally is essentially with a profit and loss statement and the financial and the business and the balance sheet, your financial statements. What that means also is that the only impacts you're measuring are the ones that are reflected on those financial statements. Because if it's not measured, it's not managed. If you don't talk about it, if people don't want to see it, nobody cares about it. So the soot that comes out of your chimney when you produce energy by burning coal, that affects people have asthma because of this, people die because of this, it makes air, it pollutes the air. By itself, that doesn't, there's no line item for that on the normal P&L. So since every kind of activity as a company, whether you're making doors, you make airplanes, cars, whatever it is, shoes, you don't just need financial resources to make it. You also need natural resources and human resources. And for us as individuals and as companies to be able to assess how our activities affect the environment around us, we need to measure and we need to report on both. That's what I like to call impact accountability. And in a way that reports it out and makes clear what you do, but also helps you make the right decisions. And I like to talk about, rather than just presenting, I'd like to actually talk with you about a bit more what this means for you as students and then as graduates as you look for a job or maybe even want to build your own company and what it means for companies. Yes? That is a case where it's probably not so easy for you to really bring it down to a solid number saying, I produced 1,000 cars last month. I needed so much energy that came out of a chimney. It created 30,000 tons of CO2, which is responsible for 5 deaths. I think you can't probably do such a very precise connection, but there is plenty of evidence out there collected by third parties and scientists and others who were concerned about that issue that you know there is at least a link, a direct, concrete, specific link between the pollution level in the air and the level of asthma that people have and people even die. I mean, I don't know the exact number, but I think in the US alone, we have thousands of these, I think, deaths that we can directly connect to the pollution of the air, which of course comes from a lot of sources too. It's not just, it's our cars, right, that we drive individually. It's the chimney of a plant. It's energy for households. It's a multitude of effects there, but your activity with that one plant that you're running using energy contributes to that. Because you're going to an interesting point, I'd like to just explain on this too. Because the one way is for you to think in terms that you just did. How many did I affect? How this is also going to affect your decisions, how you run that plant is your customers will ask you. Wood, for example, is a great example. IKEA, the Swedish company. Well, you probably all assembled some IKEA products. they faced a huge backlash from their customers because of the formaldehyde that was contained in the wood. And they don't do that anymore. And they don't because their stores were boycotted all over the globe. The problem was raised to a higher level. And it wasn't a matter of them having to prove, if you want, how many people died or didn't die because they were exposed to their wood. It was just the sheer fact that it was a contributor to that, and couldn't you, and also the fact that you could produce that wood in a different way and take the formaldehyde out, which they did. And there are lots of examples like this around Levi's, the jeans company. This was back in the 70s. They were confronted with a lot of protests around the sweatshops, as they call it, in the Far East. I don't know the exact date anymore, but I think in the early 80s, Levi's closed all the factories and stopped buying from all their tool manufacturers in the Far East because they did not have enough control to know how those products were made there. Now they're back out there again, but they have a long list of things that every one of their tool manufacturers needs to apply to, needs to be controlled, needs to subscribe to make sure that there are no 10-year-olds working in those plants. So it's more that kind of force, if you want, market force that comes back to you, whether it is from your customers, investors ask the same questions, insurance companies. You know, nowadays, the larger insurance companies, if you want directors and officers insurance for your company, they want to know what their exposure to climate change is. What's your exposure to rising sea levels? They literally want to know that. So whether you want it or not, if you want to deal with them, if you want to buy insurance, if you want them to insure you, you have to provide that information. So there's a lot. I like to call it there is the do it because it's the right thing to do way, and there is the way you have to do it because somebody asks you to, and you don't get to sell them or you don't get to deal with them if you don't comply there. And to spin off that, any follow-up questions on that or a comment? Yes. Call me Bernie, that's fine.
Business major, business management, so minor finance and entrepreneurship. Quick intro. But I need clarification. So basically your organization convinces other business to be more sustainable because of how they affect people's lives and the environment that's around them, correct? So with that being said, do you convince them to be more sustainable because of what they affect around them, or more so with numbers, as far as like money? Because when you think of being more natural or being more holistic, people, most organizations would say, well, that doesn't bring much profit. That's what I always hear. So how do you convince them, okay, if you do this a better way, you can also bring in more money or more profit?
All right. Does that make sense? Yeah, it makes. I need to clarify this. We help entrepreneurs build their businesses. And we have this focus on them being green, clean tech, sustainable businesses. That just happens to be our focus. We're, as the accelerator, we're not so much out there telling other businesses or established businesses how they should do this better. What I do more as sort of my personal mission, because I do, this is sort of my day job working with these entrepreneurs, I work with companies, I work with students like this group here to sort of share the experience of that and to explain the need, again, for us all to operate more responsibly. So it's not so much telling them what to do, but it's sort of by selection of our program, these entrepreneurs are with us. Now, we have entrepreneurs who, for example, a fellow has a rainwater collection business. And that's partly different because he thinks we're wasting water. Water is a big issue. It's a problem for our society. I want to help solve this, and here's what I do. But in his particular case, probably to a larger degree, It's a business opportunity. It's a problem that needs solving. I have a solution for it. I can sell it for a price because I bring value to those who deal with the problem. So it makes a profit. And bringing it back to this, triple bottom line includes profits. Only because since money is one of the resources you're using, you cannot just spending it and have negative returns. You need to show a profit. That's fine. Nothing wrong with that. It's just that when you think a little further, you need to make a profit while also not destroying this over here or mistreating people over there. That's the triple bottom line. People, profits, and planet. Did that answer your question? Anything else? So how is this actually done? I'm going to just, before I get to the next piece of showing how companies actually deal with this, how is this handled nowadays? And what I'm getting at is stuff like this, that if you took, for example, let's look at utilities, your power generation companies, just as an industry. What you do in producing this thing that you're selling uses resources. The only place where we measure the impact of that is in the P&L. There are lots of things that a power company does that affects the community around it that is never reflected on any P&L. We talked about asthma earlier, we talked about land requirements, waste disposal, mountaintop removal, those kinds of things. None of this has a cost on the P&L of that company, but it has a cost to all of us around that business. You look at oil, damage from spills, carbon emission, transportation. Many of you, I'm sure, are familiar with the issues around what impact petroleum has, and the use of it does not exist in a P&L either. High tech, using rare earth minerals for the motherboards and such that you use in making those things run. Automation has consequences. The impacts of those initiatives are not reflected on the P&L either. Farming, the same thing. The land that's being used, the water that's being used, the fertilizers that wash into the river downstream and creates algae blooms that then suffocate life in the water. Hospitality, near and dear to me because my son used to work there. I saw this happening daily, where businesses are run on a seasonal basis. They're open for 3 months, they close for two, they open again for another five and close for another, whatever. And they literally, through all this time, hire people, fire people, hire people, fire people. And those folks then, in order to survive, need unemployment insurance, need perhaps other kinds of help, costs that are associated with running that business, but they are borne not by the business itself, but by the rest, the public, as I call it here. Before I go there, let me just come back. The point being that not all the costs of making something are actually reflected in the costs that we ultimately see and the prices that we pay. And when we have a system, our free market capitalist system that depends on markets, free markets where somebody offers something and somebody else wants to buy it, and you have supply and demand, and you come up with a price that they accept for the product and you're willing to pay, that only works or works well if the prices actually reflect all the costs. And many of the issues we're faced with today is that these are called externalities. They're not reflected in the calculations of these market participants. It's the public at large that pays it. For that system to work well, prices need to include all the costs. Again, that's me speaking. For me, that's something fundamental that we need to address. As somebody a lot wiser than me once said, socialism collapsed because they did not take care of the economic costs of their activities. Capitalism will collect if we don't account for the human and natural costs of how we do things. We need to take care of this. Does this make sense? Does this create any questions? Or so what I like to show you, for one, I like to go with what this means for you as students and graduates, as you prepare yourselves for jobs, maybe even building your own company, and what companies do. Just a few examples. Microsoft. They, again, because they want to make sure they take care of all the costs that are there as a result of them making the things they sell us, they actually have their own carbon price. They go through a series of calculations. It's not a black and white kind of thing. But they, for example, look at their general carbon footprint. They look at what would it take for this to be compensated. And they come up with a list of projects they would like to support, whether that's, that might be protecting forests, that might be e-bikes, that might be renewable energy programs. They add these costs up, and then they divvy these costs up to each of their business units. So in Microsoft, if you come with a project to senior management and say, I want to invest $10 million to do that, when they calculate their internal rate of return for that project, and whether it reaches a certain hurdle rate or not, there is a carbon price incorporated in this. As you know, there's discussion going around whether we should have a nationwide carbon price. That's quite a bit down the road, probably. But this just to show that there are companies who take that step. Google does the same thing around carbon. They do it a little differently. They don't have a carbon price at the moment internally, but they want to consume only renewable energy. So they invest a lot in solar power, other renewable energy, wind farms. They invest a lot of money into the grid of collecting that wind power offshore and bringing it into the rest of the grid, that kind of thing. Again, just an example of what some do. Coca-Cola is another example, around water. I'm not sure whether this was an article actually that on Mukhtar Kent, their retiring president, talking about really a bit of an epiphany. You may remember that when Coca-Cola was building their business in India, they ran into very strong headwinds in many of their communities because they were accused of consuming too much water. Partly because of, I mean, all legal, they didn't do anything illegal, but they bought that water, they pulled it out of the aquifers around their plant, and it impacted those communities. So what Mukhtar Kent said is, I realized that we have very specific impacts on the community around us. And they took measures. So much so that I think late last year, they reached what they call water neutrality. They don't consume more water than what they put back. Now, that doesn't work plant by plant necessarily, but they may have a plant in India that consumes, for whatever reason, a bit more water than that's there, but they have other projects in other places that return more water to where they are. So that as a whole, they are what they call water neutral. And they actually have third parties verifying that statement. So again, a case where a company, because not necessarily only because it's the right thing to do, but because they got so much pushback from their consumers, and they can't say it directly, we realized we're losing customers because they don't want to buy from us because they think we treat the communities badly where we operate. We've got to change this, and they did. Novartis is a Swiss pharmaceutical company. And years back, I'm not quite sure when that happened, I think this was in the 90s or something, early 2000s, they actually surveyed every location where they were, whether they were paying a living wage, which in itself is not a black and white kind of an answer, that's different from place to place. But anyway, they went through the process and eliminated the issue where it was. Again, no regulation required, no law, no, just the pressure from their customers and employees and vendors to do things differently. Apple, another interesting case actually, they get a lot of pushback. They're not exactly known as the most sustainable company, if you remember. They are relative to other companies in that space, they were a bit behind, but got a lot of pressure from their customers and investors about their carbon footprint, how sustainably they use wood for a lot of the packaging material, which is a big cost and a big impact of what they do. So they decided to physically actually buy land. Together with the Conservation Fund, with World Wildlife Fund, they bought they own now a lot of land, forests, in Asia, assuring them that they can use packaging materials that are made from sustainably produced fiber. Again, something that the company did. Unilever goes even further, they crowdsource for sustainability projects. Subaru and many others have, I think Subaru by now has all their plants as zero waste plants, they don't throw anything away. There are, and this is where people like you come in. Any questions so far, by the way? Please interrupt me when something raises a comment or a question. Or as you think about yourself, what you want to do down the road, whether it is being employed by a company and finding a company whose values suit you, or whether you want to build your own company. I call it, some others call it social hedging, in a sense what's meant by this is not every company is in the position to do, for example, what Microsoft did, creating their own internal carbon price. Maybe they think their investors won't allow them to do that, or whatever the problem is. So one way around this, instead of you as a company, instead of Microsoft, excuse me real quick, instead of Microsoft instituting this carbon price, or instead of Google consuming energy that's produced renewably, you can compensate for that. You can buy what's called offsets. Somebody has produced renewable energy that would otherwise not have been produced. They get credits for that, and there are actually markets for that. There are organizations around land conservation that partner up with NGOs, with other private funds. They collect fund. You can invest money in their fund, and they use that money to buy land, in some of these cases, for example, in Costa Rica, which is then protected from being mowed down, the forest being cleared. And because of the local regulations, they get some credits for that, and those credits can in turn be traded on an exchange. These are all opportunities for individual entrepreneurs to create a project, create a business that does something like this to mitigate these impacts. And companies who need to compensate what they do, but can't directly stop doing it, can at least help you do what you do and pay you for that. So there are literally, and I'd love to, we talked before, I'd love to actually work with students, learn it in other places, to just wrap our heads around what are some of these issues around us from pollution to, you know, water, forestry, to gentrification of neighborhoods, housing becoming unaffordable, all those issues that we have around us don't necessarily only be resolved by decree or by laws or a government initiative. We have one of the companies in our program that whose business plan is to develop housing on the west and southwest side of Atlanta in a combination of for-profit and non-profit to make, and they want to build zero energy houses, making money on some of them and subsidize using some of their profits to subsidize housing in on other buildings that they constructed to allow a different group of buyers to live there, even though their incomes wouldn't allow to buy the houses that they sell on a profit. You had a question. How to get into a sustainable business.
Yeah, if any of the entrepreneurs who want to get started, where would they start?
And we're usually there with them when they start. That's our role, right? So what we do, there is actually a relatively well-known tool that most people use in this space, and it's called the Business Model Canvas. If you want to Google that later on, if anybody's interested, I can send you some information on it. It's a very convenient, it's not magic, right? There's nothing dramatically new, but what this does is on one sheet of paper, it lists your value proposition, what is it that you want to offer to your customers. It lists who your customers are going to be, your distribution channels, the resources you need, the funding you need for that, and how you're going to measure it, sort of on one page. And what we often do when somebody comes with that question, or maybe with a bit of an idea to this, you can print this out in a, I don't know, put something on the wall and work with post-it notes, and just in a brainstorming kind of a fashion to go about and fill these open spaces in. The key around all this, and really our role in this, and this is not just me talking, we have 40, 50 mentors around us who we usually work with entrepreneurs by putting a team of advisors of about 2-3 people next to them for about 2-3 years. We work a long term. And we go through that process over and over again, because you might come to us with a brilliant idea, and after sitting over this a little bit, say, well, there's something here that doesn't work. Or it seems to work, and in this process that's generally called customer discovery, as you go out and you try to find people who are actually willing to pay for what you offer, you find out there aren't that many who are willing to pay. Something's missing. But you get feedback. And you realize that rather than going down this path, maybe it's over here. Generally, that they call this pivoting, this infamous pivots. Happen all the time. And our role in this is to sort of ask the probing questions. Are you sure this works? Is this not just an assumption you're making? Did you really find this validated in the market? Maybe you need to redesign the product. Maybe you need to distribute it through a different channel. Maybe your customer is not over there, but these are your customers. So it's a longer answer to your question. It's an ongoing process, and you're never really done with it, because even once you are, you think you are, and you have revenue, you have customers, there is competition around the corner who will throw you off. So in the interest of time, to sort of come back to what does this really mean for students? For one thing, while I see a use and a need for sustainability courses that teach you something around sustainability, in whatever form it is. Some colleges even have sustainability degrees. That could make sense for some, but I believe it, for one thing, what it does is it creates a function like sustainability. Sustainability is not a function. It's not something that the people do with the VP of sustainability on the fifth floor. It's something that happens in manufacturing, in marketing, in procurement, everywhere. So, in my opinion, the more promising way to build yourself a skill set that lets you do this is foremost, get good at something. Acquire a skill set that is maybe in marketing, it's in procurement, it's in manufacturing, accounting, whatever it is. You need to be able to go to a company and say, I can help you solve the problems you're dealing with on a daily basis. And with a little bit of general knowledge about sustainability, you can at least bring sustainability aspects into those daily decision-making processes you go through at that place of work. And whatever you need at that point, whatever you need in further knowledge and skills to deal with those issues, they're available online. You can take online courses, you can go to a week-long course somewhere, you can go a weekend seminar, you can go back to school and maybe parallel to your work, acquire some additional knowledge. It is, from where I'm sitting, it's more important to be relevant to your future employer by a certain skill, a very tangible skill you bring, but have those other soft skills, how to deal with people, all that around you, and bring the sustainability aspects to your work as you become more accepted with your peers at your place of work, and you demonstrate that you actually bring value and help them solve problems. If that makes sense.
Brian, I'd just like to find out, anybody here work for a company that's into sustainability? What company and where are they going?
I am the founder of a company called Greenville, and my company dispense laundry detergent straight into the washing machine, and we get rid of the bottles. Our dispenser serves up to 10 machines, and we use solid soap. So a 5-pound solid soap, the dispenser splashes water on it, and it creates 532 loads of liquid detergent. So we're...
For residential application or for commercial application?
It's for commercial application. It serves 10 machines. One dispenser serves up to 10 machines.
Yep.
So, and I'm a startup. With ATDC, I'm going through their incubator. But I wanted to know, one of the reasons I'm here is I wanted to know, are there other green financing or initiatives or anything that's a piece that they don't really, can help me with? I just was wondering what is available.
Yeah, and I can say, if you send me your email address, I can send you a resource list there.
Okay, great.
One of the reasons why I'm also doing this and talking to you about this space and what opportunities there are in it, when it comes to startup entrepreneurs, we're not exactly overwhelmed by entrepreneurs who need help in the clean tech space. Here around Atlanta in the Southeast, when you look at the financing side, look where angel investors invest their money. In Atlanta, it is financial tech, it is IT generally, it is medical devices, a lot to do with cloud-based computing and code writing, ATC, and there is ATDC is a lot of that too, although they have others there as well. It's mainly tech. You go in there, you see a bunch of engineers writing code. Extremely busy, very, very, a lot of buzz. But that's where the focus is, and that's where investors in this part of the country are also used to assess the risk and put their money in early. So honestly speaking, we find it difficult for our entrepreneurs to find that early stage money. In clean tech, it's actually even a bit more difficult because if you have a solar project, or we have a woman that has a magnetic gearing that lets her produce energy from water. hydropower in a smaller, modular way, but twice the size here, out of waterways, you're not going to be able to test that. You're not even going to be able to build your prototype for $20,000 or $50,000. It costs a little bit more money early on to prove your technology and say that my idea actually works. That makes it even more difficult. So one of the things we actually work on, and we've had a couple of success stories, but it's not quite so easy, is to help entrepreneurs keep their company and build your company without third-party capital. Because obviously, as you do this early, it's expensive, right? Because you're a big risk. You haven't proven out much yet. Your technology might not even work yet. You don't have any customers. So to find ways where you can bootstrap it, maybe you, instead of doing this, what you have imagined, you may be building just a small part of it, find some customers for that, sell it. We have one particular customer who's selling some unique energy-efficient lighting. He was willing to give a major part of his company away. And a colleague of mine, who was his advisor, sat down with him and said, no, you don't. You look how this could work. Turned over some rocks, looked around how he could organize his business. He has now a multi-million dollar business, still in the single digits, but he has customers, he makes money, and still owns more than 90% of the company. That doesn't work all the time, but part of our role we see, especially in this space, especially in this part of the country, is to help those entrepreneurs keep the company. It's a lot easier to get financing for this out on the West Coast or up in the Northeast, but part of our role is also to help entrepreneurs and to help create sustainable jobs here. We don't want them to go somewhere else because that's where the money is. Any other questions around, especially what?
There will be here afterwards if anybody wants to talk. But I want to thank you on behalf of us and College Business, a little memento.
Thank you much.
You can throw it at anybody wants.
I used to play ice hockey.
Yeah. Appreciate it, Brian. Thank you.